Hey guys, this episode of the Smoking Tire Podcast is brought to you by Private Internet Access. Listen, here's a secret for you. Private browsing mode on your phone is not really keeping you private. Private Internet Access, a VPN, will keep you private. You can use Private Internet Access to keep anything that you do online away from your internet service provider, hackers, or any snoopers. All your traffic goes through a secure VPN tunnel. Your IP address is hidden and your data is encrypted. Now, what that means is you are convincing the internet that you are someone else somewhere else, right? And that can be used for all kinds of ways, to hide your true identity, to hide your data from any snoopers, but also to watch geo-restricted content on streaming services that would otherwise be unavailable to you due to your location. Private Internet Access is available for all platforms, including iOS and Android, and you can use one subscription to protect up to 10 devices at the same time. There's a 30-day money-back guarantee in place, and only by using our link can you get complete digital privacy for less than $3 a month and 3 extra months for free. Now, the link, privateinternetaccess.com/tire. That's privateinternetaccess.com/tire. Now you get complete digital privacy for less than $3 a month and 3 extra months for free at privateinternetaccess.com/tire. We are also brought to you by Crown and Caliber. Crown and Caliber is the official watch retailer of the Smoking Tire Podcast. The thing is about watches, right? You almost never, unless it's some kind of new hot release, you almost never want to buy them new. There's all the value is in buying them used, secondhand. They're usually taken care of better than secondhand cars. They last even longer than cars, and they're very easy to service and maintain. Crown & Caliber has a staff of technicians on site to make sure that the watch they're selling you is in good working order, and they have a limited mechanical warranty for even if you have an issue later with your used mechanical watch. Now, go to crownandcaliber.com to get the best value in used pre-owned luxury watches from all the biggest brands: Rolex, Omega, Panerai, Patek, Audemars, etc., etc., etc. They've been with us for a long time, guys, and they really are taking good care of us and the people who listen to our show at crownandcaliber.com. We're also brought to you by Liquid IV. Now, this, it sounds interesting, right? But they sent me a bunch of the Liquid IV. It's hydration amplifying stuff. Basically, people get dehydrated, right? No one drinks enough water. I get dehydrated. I actually just had to do a special 24-hour urine test because my muscle enzymes were indicating that I am dehydrated, right? But with Liquid IV, you've got the fastest, most efficient way to stay hydrated. Each serving helps you get as much hydration as 2 to 3 bottles of water. I've tried it. It tastes pretty good, and it helps me. It actually did help me get, you know, stay, have energy throughout my workout. I did use it during my workout. With Liquid IV, you get the fastest, most efficient way to stay hydrated. It's packed with potassium, vitamin C, and other vitamins known to help your body defend against infections. Now, proper hydration can boost your immunity, right? And Liquid IV contains five essential vitamins, more vitamin C than an orange, and as much potassium as a banana. It's healthier than sugary sports drinks, and there's no artificial flavors or preservatives. There's less sugar than an apple. It's non-GMO, vegan, and free of gluten, dairy, and soy. So Liquid IV is available nationwide at Costco and Target, or you can get 25% off your purchase when you go to liquidiv.com and use code TST at checkout. That's liquidiv.com and code TST at checkout. 25% off of anything on the site at liquidiv.com and use code TST at checkout. ShipStation, guys. ShipStation. It does exactly the thing that it sounds like it does. It turns your home computer into a shipping station. The holiday season is right around the corner. This year, we know that people are gonna be buying more stuff online than ever before. Why? Who's even having a Black Friday this year? Everything is gonna be online. And are you ready to meet the demands of a record-breaking online shopping season? Well, you can be with ShipStation. Listen, when you're selling online, you get a massive amount of orders, and getting them out quickly can be tough. I know, because I have tried to sell shirts myself and manage the product and ship it out, and it was terrible. How do you keep track of who gets what shipping carrier should use? Are you getting the best prices? That's why it's all about ShipStation.com. It's the fastest, easiest, and most affordable way to manage and ship your orders. In just a few clicks, you're managing orders, printing out discounted shipping labels, and getting your products out fast. The result? Happier holidays for you and your customers. ShipStation takes all the hassle out of holiday shipping. Now, right now, the Smoking Tire listeners can try ShipStation for free for 60 days when you use offer code TIRE. Make sure your business is ready to meet the demands of a massive online shopping season. Get started at ShipStation.com today and use offer code TIRE. You click the microphone at the top of the page and click TIRE. That's ShipStation.com, offer code TIRE, the microphone at the top of the page. You know how it goes. ShipStation.com, guys. Make ship happen. All right, on this episode of the Smoking Tire Podcast, Paul Zuckerman and Spike Feresten of Spike's Car Radio are in the house. We do each other's shows all the time, and you know it's going to be a total zoo when Zuckerman's in the house. He has some legal advice for us. We spend about 30 minutes on cats. We talk about original versus restored, and there's plenty of quotable moments. Zuckerman and Feresten on the Smoking Tire Podcast.
And, but now this is the show. This is it.
We're in it now.
Okay.
Zuckerman and Feresten.
In it to win it.
Zuckerman and Feresten in the
Cheers.
House. L'chaim. L'chaim.
Hello.
L'chaim to life, yeah.
Spike, let's drop in on the fact that I drove your Beetle today for the second time. Drove it here, drove it back. Far and away the nicest driving Beetle I've ever driven. I've driven three or four Beetles, all of which were absolute hemorrhagic dog shit. This one was lovely.
Look at how good Matt looks in this.
Why is Spike's German police Beetle so much better than all the other Beetles?
Anything sourced by Jerry is going to be better than anything else. Oh,
wait a minute. You know I had to do a bit of sorting when it was sourced from Jerry. In fact,
when
on that first drive, it had no brakes. I remember
Jerry
the brake pedal.
Feresten finished.
The brake pedal went to the floor of the car. And I was like, God, it's got zero brakes. Not
this
a little,
is.
Zero.
And not, two the single kids. Circuit, the two, not the dual circuit.
I had no circuits, and I had two kids in the car, and they go, what do you want to do? And I said, let's drive home, see if we make it. And we use the emergency brake. Yeah.
We're
fine.
Handbrake works, too.
It's like 40 pounds of foot torque, 40 pounds of torque, nothing, no horsepower.
But now that the vehicle is safely back in your hangar, I can tell you what I did with it.
Yeah, go ahead.
We were leveling the lifts.
Right.
And so when they install these amazing Park Plus lifts outside the window here in the shop, after like 30 days of having cars on them, the cables, which are like ski lift cables, like big, they stretch a little bit. And it's fine. It's like not dangerous or anything. But the trays become a little bit uneven with each other. And you want... that perfectly, you want them to line up right. So in order to level them, we ran the Beetle up and down every single lift on Friday.
Wow.
Because you know why? It has really good ground clearance.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just easy to just, it was so easy to just pop it right onto the tray and then pop it right back on.
I want to see pictures. I want to see it up high.
There were pictures of it. No?
No, when I saw it, when I came for your open house, it was down on the ground floor.
Oh, yeah,
you know
what? We put it up in the sky, and then brought it down on the floor because it looks so good next to Bruce's police car.
Right.
Originally, we were going to stack them on top of each other, but then I thought, they were so good, you wanted to see all of them.
Well, that is a Mexican-made Beetle that was built and manufactured in Mexico, then sent to Würzburg, Germany used, right? Where they... weren't they making them in 70,
yes.
77,
no, in Germany,
78?
They ceased in Germany much sooner than they ceased in Mexico. Brazil was actually the last
Brazil
place.
Was like 2002 or something.
Right.
Yeah.
But there's a Mexican VIN number, and it says Mexico in it. I saw that for the first time just a few months ago. And
That's so funny.
Then I had it down at the hangar, and Jerry let me drive one of his 60s Beetles. And that Beetle was so much more together than this 79 Mexican Beetle.
Because it was German built, you think?
Yeah. Yeah, much more solid.
It's like Stratocasters.
Yeah. But I know what you mean about mine. It zooms and it zips
it's for
working,
a Beetle,
right.
It feels really powerful.
Jerry and his guys got the engine right. I took it the rest of the way. But this Beetle, it had like driver's miles on it, 50,000 miles on it. It was a 66 or 67. And he was like, you have to try this one, Spike. You got to know that you're a Beetle guy. And he was right, and I got in this thing, and it just felt tight and together, and I thought, how can this be 13 years younger?
Yeah.
Or older,
the same tooling they probably shipped to Mexico. I bet the tooling was worn down, all the dyes and stuff. But they probably ran them things right to the end.
He's really deep in that VW Beetle.
I'd like his opinion on what the best year is, actually. Mm. Not on the record, so I could buy one first, and then we can put it on the record.
I'll text him.
Let's find out.
At some point
he likes the certain earlier ones, not the split windows, but there's certain versions he likes better. And then there is a version called the Dick Homer. Remember the Dick Homer conversation, Feresten?
Yes.
Homer.
Is it spelled like you think it's spelled?
Yes, it's spelled like you think it's spelled. And the B-pillar is a big, fat B-pillar, and it's a Dick Homer.
That's hilarious.
Yes.
Have you been to Gabriel Iglesias' Beetle collection before, or seen it, his Volkswagen collection?
Yeah, it's down south.
I've only seen pictures. It seems crazy.
It's funny. He'll let you interview him for your podcast, but you have to go down there and go down to him. He won't come up.
He's one of those guys.
That's the beat on him for everything, by the way.
Really?
Like, you can go. He'll pitch a show.
He'll film his stand-up comedy specials in his bedroom.
You have to drive down. I think it was Long Beach or somewhere past Long Beach. He's not going to come to you.
Well, that's the dream, isn't it? In L.A. to be famous enough that you don't actually have to fight traffic ever.
Yeah,
he's terrific.
Yeah, there he
that
is.
That black and red is fabulous.
Look at that.
It's a great collection.
I'd go for that. I'd go down.
We got
visited.
You want to drive down?
Yeah, let's
Can I come? I
want to
see.
Let's all go.
Let's get into something
small. Record the bitching show at Gabriel Iglesias'
place. Don't we
want
Gabriel to tell us what the best year is for the Volkswagen Beetle?
He probably knows.
Yeah, he probably knows.
He probably gives you an answer that's just... Jerry will be like, 58, and that'll be it.
He's got a lot of these things.
I feel like if you wound up Gabriel Iglesias, he'd give you 35 minutes on it, easy.
You know, Pappas has a little secret VW collection.
My favorite secret collection of Pappas's is the secret three-wheeler collection he's got in his office. Did you know about this?
Well,
he's got like a dozen of those sketchy-ass three-wheelers. That were like banned.
Yes.
Remember the
ATVs.
Quads with three wheels?
Oh, yes.
Pappas has got like a dozen of those things in his office.
He does.
Why?
His whole office is full of them.
Which us personal injury lawyers got rid of because people were flipping and getting broken, paralyzed. You know, a little case of quadriplegia, banned from marketing. You're a little paralyzed for the next
Well, how does the crash happen on one of those?
Because the three wheels
front into the right.
Yeah. So bad. It's front into the right, so you brake and turn?
In any way, I rode them when I was a kid, and it's terrifying. You slow down and turn the bars either direction, and all the weight is going forward, but all of a sudden the wheels are gone.
Ah.
So the weight just goes over that corner.
And it flips onto the poor little child's
body. That's the reason all the three-wheeled bars.
The poor child's body.
The poor little child is trapped on
like,
their neck.
You know how all the three-wheeled not-car cars, like the Polaris Slingshot and the Morgan three-wheeler and all them, think about all the three-wheeled cars, right? Uh-huh. It's always two in the front and one in the back.
Right.
And that's to...
the little tuk-tuk.
the great secrets of a rickshaw tuk-tuk rolling.
Like that. Yeah.
Well, the next question was the quad accident. Is that how the quad accident happens?
Mm-hmm.
You go forward and then it comes on top of
you. You have to try a lot harder to pitch the quad than the trike.
I've read a few accidents.
Yeah. I mean, think about Carver. Remember that Top Gear Reliant Robin segment? It's like one of the best segments ever televised about cars. And the whole thing was about how easy it was to roll. And a four-wheeled car just doesn't do that. That's the same thing.
And if you put the two wheels in the front, not the back, they don't flip over either.
Oh, man, Zach, look at that picture you just accidentally found of the guy doing a sidecar trick on the Morgan three-wheeler. Like, there's a guy, like, hanging off the side of a
that's,
Morgan.
That's sidecar racing. Have you ever seen that?
That looks like a Morgan three-wheeler. That doesn't look like a sidecar.
Look
dude.
At the guy right below him doing the same thing with a brick wall.
That's a riding mechanic Morgan three-wheeler.
Good, click on him.
He's there he is. Same thing.
Same guy.
And look at him.
This
he
is
was
me
killed.
Now.
Oh, he was killed.
That was his obituary.
That was a family-moving tribute to his.
Why would he take that picture for his obituary picture? This is me with one leg on a brick wall? What is he doing?
Because the awkward kids don't really have it. No. Sidecar racing. Especially when that guy's like flying the sidecar, and these guys are out of their minds.
They're not Jewish. They're no Jews.
They're not.
Jews don't camp.
Jews also don't ride sidecar motorcycles. No. Why are we looking at this?
I also spent a little time driving your Audi Sport Quattro, which is quite the interesting machine.
Yes, it is.
What a weird car.
Weird.
really weird.
So many weird items too. from the janky weird VW ignition.
Yeah.
Did you notice that?
I did. Yes.
Yeah.
Although I mean, you know, the interior is generally pretty parts bin in that thing.
And then,
but the engine is really something.
Yeah, it's rad.
Because you got to rev the snot out of it. Like you got to like. Get it past 5.6, and then it's like, whoa, this
yes,
thing pulls like a motherfucker.
It gets some real momentum going.
Real Third momentum. Gear is very good.
Yes.
That's the gear in that
yeah,
car.
Yeah, it's like you're taking off.
But that short wheelbase, you know, even if you're just going down the highway and you just do one of these, the short wheelbase makes it feel like it's going to pitch the back end out. Just, it's like, it's
That's
meant for that flip.
To do.
I know. It's like, but street cars like, don't do that. It's like, it's so clearly like not meant to be a street
right.
car at all.
But wherever you point it, that it goes.
But at the same time, like, it's quiet, like it's like enough, and it's like like I drove it around. I drove it 10 miles with no plates on it, and like nobody gives a fuck. No one looks. It's like it's very invisible at the same time, unless someone knows what it is,
and then
they
freak out,
lose their minds.
Yeah,
yeah, really interesting car.
Yeah, it is. And then you checked out the body panels and the Kevlar and all of the weird uses that they had for things like Kevlar fiberglass, heat shields made of aluminum.
That Kevlar thing that surrounds like the radiator yes. is crazy. It's like yes. a crazy old school Kevlar ducting piece. It's yeah. really, really cool. It really captures all the air going through the radiator.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the radiator itself is off to the side because what you think is the radiator is just the oil cooler in front where you think a radiator would be.
Yeah, they actually put the oil cooler like in front of the radiator yeah. and it's like it really dominates the whole front end. That car was awesome.
Yeah.
Weird. And if we've got a Lancia Delta Integrale downstairs, and when you park them side by side, there's just like so many similar design cues. It's like really neat to see those cars next to each other.
Are you driving that car, Zuckerman?
I think I'm going to drive it tonight.
So you're enjoying it around the city.
Yes,
it's easy.
Very, very much so.
I didn't turn it on. Does it have air conditioning?
Yeah.
It does? I didn't try.
It works good. It's got good AC. It's got a decent enough stereo. Decent enough for me, right?
And it's like... Yeah, do you have any cassettes? You got cassettes, don't cassettes. You?
He listens to Foghat.
Yeah. Fool for the City. Fool for the City is not bad. And maybe a little Thin Lizzy. You know, the boys are back in town.
What year
I picture
it,
like Adam Sandler 86, and Billy Madison 86. Like rolling up to the chick is up, the heat is on, they finally
yeah,
found
Yeah, you need
me.
Music from 86 for that thing
The Renegades,
to work.
That sticks, Renegades.
So what is
oh,
that?
It is. Okay, 86, was there anything good in 86? Maybe
music?
The Pixies.
You got the beat.
No, I'm a Pixies. From
Pixies
that era,
would be
I would
great.
Be Pixies.
Pixies
in
a, that's a good call.
Oh, yes,
that's
sir,
awfully authentic of you, Zuckerman.
I love the Pixies.
Don't underestimate
They're
me.
Great.
I never do.
Do not underestimate me, sir.
I definitely never do.
Pixies would be amazing.
You should never underestimate Zuckerman.
Here comes your man.
Especially in a court of law.
Yes.
Monkey
Fuck
gone to heaven.
Take your fucking money. I'm going to strangle you with my mind.
You don't have you don't have Zuckerman car.
That's how it works.
What? You strangle somebody with your mind?
Yes, and then the money comes. Remember Underdog when he shakes the guy upside down. I'm doing
I'm
that
so
with
excited.
My mind.
No, oh I get these God. Calls all the time from, I'm so excited, Spike. You're not going to believe how lucky I am. How lucky are you? There's a construction worker in my, and he starts whispering, there's a construction worker in my conference room. Landed balls first on a piece of rebar. Listen. The guy's not going to be able to have kids. I'm going to get a second house. How lucky am I? How lucky am I, Spike?
These are direct quotes.
And I said, why are you happy? That's the most horrible story I've ever... This husband... He's leaning on the gravestone, pushes it over, it falls and kills his wife. We're suing the cemetery. I'm going to get another Audi rally car out of this. It's so great. You should see. Here, look at the picture of her crushed head. It's like watermelon and mashed potatoes all in one. Look at it.
That's like Monday at 11.
Oh yes. Yes, I love it.
Yeah, you love
Who
it.
Who would it's, think the comedic?
That,
yeah.
Oh,
but
God.
your tolerance for gore and these stories is beyond anything that I can comprehend. These are horrible stories.
He's like a Facebook content checker at this point. Totally yes. desensitized.
Totally desensitized.
Yeah, just turn that filth into money. It's all it is.
His fingers, his hand is like hamburger. Look, it's just like a stump with something coming up. What is that stick?
fucking out.
For every ounce of hamburger, it's another Carrera RS.
Exactly.
Meanwhile, Farrah, I just got a, I got a first timer after 30 years, a cat attack.
Wow.
Oh, fucking, no.
Fucking house cat.
What is my exposure?
Hundreds of thousands
fuck
of dollars.
Fuck out of here, really?
I'm telling you, dude. I didn't believe
it. What did
it
do to the person?
Tore her face off.
No. He really had, he had it for a second. His deadpan was really good.
Face is gone.
He took her face off.
Is she going to be your client by the end of this laughing fit?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, wait, he's Nick Cage in the courtroom.
When she gets a private jet from that cat, she'll love him.
Hold on. There's so many questions. How does a cat get access to the face that long? Like, I mean, it's not fast. A little cat.
That's what I'm trying to figure out, Feresten.
If you hold a cat wrong, a cat could fuck you up. Like,
I know, but what
me and my wife have both been scratched really badly by cats that, by cats that love us.
You try to get the cat into the vet's office. It knows it's there. It's holding on to the fucking
car. It her own cat? No, because you can't sue yourself, obviously.
Your
right.
Is somebody,
sorry, I'm a dumbass. In case you're wondering if I'm a dumbass,
your house and Hannah's house and said, look at the nice cats. And then they jumped on her face.
Oh, shit. That's a good point.
So, really?
I have an umbrella liability policy. Does that cover cat attacks?
Yeah.
It does?
Yeah.
Do I have to have my cats as additional named insured? Do I need to call my agent?
God willing, they'll attack someone. God willing, Feresten walks in there. They tear him to shreds.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Cat attack. Fuck. You going to win?
Of course I'm going to win. Me versus a cat?
Is there a statute on that? I guess your pets, right? Same as a dog bite, right? Same shit.
Yeah. What kind of cats were they?
Feresten, I'm going to get you all of
these.
All of
they the were cats. Very sweet cats. I swear they're never like this.
I got a call from a referring attorney who said, can you handle this case? A cat attacked this lady's face. Sent me a picture. It was like, holy shit, this lady's face is fucked up. And yes.
Did you send him back a picture of a Carrera RS? Lightweight?
Said, this yes, is how I much can, money we're going to make.
I can handle this.
Yeah. You're like on your own episode of like Legal Chopped, and they're like, here's a basket with a bunch of ingredients. You're like, that's a cat attacking your face. Like, I can turn that into money.
Wow. If you're the lady.
Did the cats leap? Did the woman hold the cat up?
I have not had the in-person interview, Feresten. I can't tell you
I'd like
all
to come
of the
in
pertinent
for this
details.
One.
I'm going to get all of the pertinent logistical details.
I will sign up to be your investigator.
I'm going to assume, here's what I've seen with dogs. Lady leans in to kiss.
The cat that
she does not know, or the dog, gets her face right next to the cat.
Yeah.
And then the unknown animal.
Right. There's a specific way you have to hold cats, and if you don't know how to hold a cat will fucking claw you.
Stomach, don't touch the stomach.
And
that's
also,
the death zone.
Don't put a cat you don't know very well near your face.
Yes.
Seriously, it's a really bad idea.
This is a good blip ship shirt.
You could literally lose an eye from a very nice cat.
Of course.
It's
got knives.
Know. Yeah.
Yes.
Got blades. Also, don't declaw your cats.
My cats never hurt anybody. I declawed my cats.
Did you?
I had the last.
Declawed your cats?
What a fucking horrible person.
They were destroying. They were destroying our house in Hollywood.
So you destroyed them.
And they
established dominance.
There was no ban. And then they said they're going to ban declawing. This is the last day. I think we were the very last.
The very last one to do that.
One of the greatest decisions I've ever made.
Oh.
And I know people might get upset about it. My cats were so happy. We love them more. They both got cancer from... You know what they got cancer from?
Cancer
from the rabies vaccination. They both got the same cancer.
We've got an anti-vaxxer
injection
here.
Site.
Really?
Yeah. No, it was an injection site cancer from that vaccination.
Get out of here.
Side. So I don't vaccinate my animals anymore with that.
Oh,
but
anti-vaxxer, huh?
Look, okay. I understand why people don't want these claws... around. However, because it ruins, we had just done a house.
Yeah,
these cats systematically
you
ruined.
You kind of have to decide if you are going to have.
And by the way, it was
really
just one.
Nice
we
furniture.
Only did it to our one cat, and it improved our relationship. Everything worked after that. And the cat.
You and the cat, or you and your wife?
All of us. We were all happy. So,
Hannah trims our cat's claws once a week.
I tried that. I tried the little plastic nubbies you put on there, and the cat,
the nubbies don't work.
Would look at me while I was watching TV and just go. But he really was started fucking with me.
No, the idea that those nubbies would do anything is absurd. Yeah. Those are a joke.
And then it destroyed a $10,000 couch, and that was it. And I was like, you know, it's over. Look, because it was a moment where we were, you know, and we probably wouldn't make this decision now, but it was a while ago. But it was a moment where we were getting rid of the cat. It was like, you know what? Fuck you, man. I've given you a good life. I've given you a good life, my friend. And this is how you thank me?
Yeah. I feel you. I understand. Yeah. But I love that cat.
Still
wouldn't do
a terrible thing.
Cat.
You're still a piece
of shit. You're still a piece of shit.
Yeah. Definitely. I'm fine with it.
Okay. That's all right.
I'm really okay with it.
I mean, then if you're a piece of shit, but okay with it. We're both satisfied, I guess.
I also then I then put tens of thousands of dollars into cancer treatment for that cat. And I kept him alive for 2.5 years until he was not really suffering.
Did he smoke cigarettes in front of you while you're paying for it? He's like, fuck you, where are my claws?
No.
Use my paw pads.
He would just lay there and kind of bleed out his ulcer and go, you know, it might be time to go.
Oh, poor guy.
Yeah, it was awful.
What was this cat's name, Feresten?
That was Jupiats.
Sorry.
Jupiats, named by my father, Fats.
How do you spell Jupiats?
Chew, like chew.
Chewpiatz.
And Zazu was the other one.
Oh my God, this poor cat.
Everything was wrong.
Got made fun of at school.
The cat. His friends were all fucking, what race are you anyway?
Oh,
what
kind of a name is?
If you're Chewpiatz Feresten.
The whiskey and the weed.
Oh boy. Anyway.
No, they were adopted on Long Island. On the driving back from our
cats.
Little place.
Well, Goomba cats, depending on which side of Franny Lou. Yeah.
They lived in New York on the Upper East Side with me when I wrote for Letterman. Then I brought them out. We lived at the Chateau Marmont for like 2 or 3 weeks. They would escape on the roof there, and we'd have to go find them. It was quite an adventure.
That's pretty boss. And Hollywood cats.
All indoors.
They had like a
cool
Coke bender with John Belushi. The Chateau.
You know what they did that was really cool? They slept in front of the fireplace in this.
Like dogs?
Gary Cooper's old Craftsman house that I was renting for nothing. You know, I came out here after the earthquake. Everything's for rent. Like, I rent this big, beautiful house for $2,500 a month.
Where was Gary Cooper's house?
Right near Runyon Canyon.
Really?
It's a big gray house. Franklin, yep. It's right on Franklin with a red door. You can't miss it. It's right with all the old Hollywood houses.
Yeah.
Samuel Goldwyn's house was next door. Fatty Arbuckle's house. Yeah. I mean, some great old houses that nobody cared about. And the cats every night were sleeping there. And the dogs slept in the kitchen. And I come down, they're sleeping right there. And finally, you know, we had a pest guy come by. And he goes, let me ask you a question. Your cat sleep near the fireplace? I'm like, yeah. He goes, you got rats coming in through there, and that's why they're doing that. They must have been chasing the rats back up the chimney.
They were sleeping in front of the fireplace when it was not lit.
Away.
At night, they would sleep facing the fireplace downstairs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I was mystified by it. What was so interesting?
Yes.
The rats would come on the roof, and there was no grate.
And
it was just an old house that no one was taking care of, and they would drop down, and the cats would be there,
and
they'd scamper back up.
Did they ever catch one?
No, not that I know.
Conrad
of.
No, my old house in Playa del Rey, Conrad would bring in mice all the time.
I wouldn't let him out. The coyotes kill cats.
Oh yeah,
fast.
In Playa del Rey, there's no coyotes. But
do you let your cats outside?
My cats go on my balconies. They don't go outside. Like they go on the second and third floor decks.
Yeah.
They're good like that. Mm-hmm. They like an elevated vantage point. They like to like survey the area, and they have like. They sketch me out, but they have like, because they'll walk on the railing and shit, but they have like way better, really, they have really good balance.
Do you put cats in your cars? Do you ever take them for drives?
No, they really don't like that.
There's a guy saw in Malibu. He had a cat lashed to his side view mirror with a bungee cord.
Passenger side.
What?
Not fucking with you. He had a cat lashed to the side of the car.
So it was on top of the mirror.
I'm sorry, wait.
The window
was sitting on the side view fucking mirror.
Legs on like where the window comes
and he was driving?
Up. Yeah.
The guy's fuck out of here.
And the cat is lashed with bungee cords or a surfboard leash. Slowly
what?
Going through. We
was
saw
the cat appearing
we chased
having
him.
A panic
we chased
attack?
Him.
We tried to get him to stop. We wanted to talk to this guy and understand how to get the cat to stand still.
Well, you wanted to represent the cat, of course.
In that case, I just want the guy to run someone over, and then the cops to come understand the fuck's going on with the cat.
That was really the golden day of Bills. You know, the golden days when the crazies were, you know how the crazies were still out from smoking meth all night when we go there early in the morning? Yeah. They'd be walking around and saying
crazy
shit.
There was a guy
shit.
In the car that would, he would stare from across the parking lot at you.
Right, right.
And look angry and scream.
And he had new cars every, we couldn't figure out like how this nut job had a new car. We thought he was a homeless guy who was schizophrenic. Turns out he's a rich schizophrenic off his drugs.
Oh, wow.
And he would sit there and I'd be facing Zuckerman like this, talking. So the guy's over Zuckerman's shoulder. And I, Zuckerman would say something. I would laugh. Ha, and then the guy would be staring at me. He'd do this. He'd go, and then stop. And I'd look at him. And he'd look
at me. I don't
think
I've seen this guy before.
No, he was really intense. Whoa. And then he started coming in and screaming at everybody. It was fun. It was like a little bit of New York.
In L.A. What was, I didn't go last weekend. What was the update from last weekend?
I have news.
Okay, what's the news?
I am talking with one of our listeners who knows the whole story of what has been going on. First of all, there's a very sad attempt to keep everybody out of the marmalade parking lot for this Cars and Coffee. It is two pool ropes, maybe three.
It's extremely sad.
I strongly encourage you, bring your scissors, because nobody's watching. Last week, Zuckerman just kicked the cones aside, pushed the big sign aside, and Susie untied the ropes, and they went, fuck you, and everybody came in, and there was a nice little
car. It turns out a cone and a sailing rope is not enforceable.
Yes, and the pimply-faced guy with the flashlight, he's not going to be able to enforce
this. He wasn't going to be happy until I went and moved the cones. He kept looking and being agitated and looking at me.
And he was
ahead,
happy.
Okay,
because we just want people, you know, a place to park. And I was surprised people didn't just drive on through. Anyway, here's the story, all right? The Marmalade employees and the Sephora employees complained. Now, I have this on a very good source. This listener's daughter works at Sephora. She works at Sephora. They started complaining they couldn't find parking to work. So then management caught wind of it in both places, even though Marmalade is fucking killing it from our people showing up.
They're like
up.
Printing money.
So fuck you, Marmalade. Fuck you. Yeah, right? Yeah. What can you do about that?
About that?
Yeah.
Nothing.
All right, don't do anything. But I guess the kids who worked there had trouble parking. This girl who works at Sephora was like, Dad, I know you like these guys in this. And I love the car show, too, but I just want to let you know that this is going on there. And she feels bad about it. She actually feels
so
bad.
It's not
the
fireball.
Dad feels bad.
So we've been
denigrating Fireball for no reason.
Character assassination of Fireball
no,
for
but
no
he would,
reason.
But so why was he standing there telling people to leave?
Because he's fucking guilty, too. He's part of it.
Because he's been a very willing participant in shooing people away.
Fireball has a show coming up in October, and he's extremely jealous that we are just encouraging people to gather and have this show. We can't say this is our show. It's not our show. It happens spontaneously when everything else stops. And that's what we like about
scenario.
It. And everybody's,
no one to blame.
Everybody's peaceful and everybody shows up and we have nothing to do and there's no big outbreak tied to this thing. And we all, you know, everybody's going to the stores after and spending money. It's got to keep happening. And, you know, if I have to activate all of you listening there to start cutting those damn wires, start cutting them. Because they're not going to stop you. Even the police who showed up. Because apparently Sephora called the police that one day.
That was Sephora,
Sephora
of all people?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
And the management.
So embarrassing.
Makeup versus cars.
Ew.
We're going to have it out.
Why don't they take a cart and try and sell makeup to people?
Well, even the officers who showed up were like, there's some cool cars here. Why are they trying to stop it? They didn't, they're like, and they even admitted, like, we're just going to stay here for a second and just so they know that they called us and we showed up and then we're leaving. So
I have some advice. If you're this four people, you want to park, go put some cones out the night before.
Oh, yeah.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
Put some employee parking only cones out the night before.
And people will respect it.
Yeah, Marmalade, Sephora, do you hear that? Yeah. People
put
do respect
cones.
The cones.
Yeah, Marmalade, you know, customers
as you
only.
Tell people not to respect the cones.
No, but that's there.
No, Bill puts cones out, and we
right.
do that.
So if there's specific spots with a little sign that said Marmalade customers only, Sephora people only, that would work. People would respect that.
I think
that.
That's true.
Instead
I think
of
they
blocking
would.
The whole parking lot, and then we get agitated. We don't like
that. Stupid.
Yeah.
Because
what are you
going to
do?
Right.
You can't patronize the business. Okay, I'm here in my Lamborghini and I'm patronizing the business. Okay? What do you tell me? I can't drive my nice car to breakfast. I have to drive a shitbox to breakfast.
It's so weird.
Let's go there and get really face weird. Cream. We'll go to Sephora and get face cream.
It's Sunday.
They're not even open at 8 in the morning, are they?
They're not. Yeah, are they open?
No.
No.
If
no.
they are open, it's just, I'm buying $1,000 in makeup.
Okay.
To be like, here. That's stupid. That's like smashing my own shit in protest. But
no, we're giving them a huge ad right now, both of them. Sephora and Marmalade.
Maybe spend money right at here. Sephora. Be go nice there. To their employees.
Girls like it. Buy gift cards.
Yeah.
Give it to your honey.
But yeah, yeah, stop there you go. Complaining.
Yeah.
you're shooting yourselves in the foot. You've got... How many people showed up at the height of this thing? Hundreds of people
yeah.
are there, and then this show, you lose interest in it around 10, and then they're walking around spending money. Mm-hmm. Do you know what? You remember what it was? What it's been like there before this thing? It's just
dead.
Empty. Just dead, right?
True.
Very dead.
Come on.
Yeah, commerce is happening. Don't be a dickhead.
And we're having a big event there with Porsche. In when? A couple weeks.
I'm sorry, what?
Porsche's coming.
A big event is happening. You should
well,
say.
Don't a big event. Zuckerman and I are doing our podcast yes. there on the 20th. Sunday the 20th at Bill's. We're doing it outside to help launch Porsche's new subscription and rental service.
Oh, is this the... didn't they announce this a couple years ago? Did they tease it and then pull it back and now they're putting it out again?
The Porsche Drive app. It's only available in 4 cities, I think, in the United States. Los Angeles is one of them. We're launching it. We're helping them launch. They're going to have cars there. Here's the app right here. And it's...
How are you not in on this?
I don't know. I feel like I probably should be. I'm going on the Panamera launch next week.
You will be.
I'll probably be lectured on it.
I think you're in on it right now.
I think maybe.
We just let you in.
They have single drive subscription and rental. So if you wanted to, say you work in New York, you want to come to LA and just have a 911 for a month, you get this app, you put in your phone number, and then you press a button, it gets delivered to you. You
nice.
Can switch
Not
cars
bad, huh?
between trucks and everything else. You can also just rent a 911 for the weekend like Turo.
Oh, now. Cool.
Yeah.
When they originally launched it or announced it like a couple years ago, there was like two levels. There was like level one,
right.
level two, and level one was like Cayman, Boxster, Macan, and level two... was like Cayenne 911 Panamera.
Exactly.
We need level three.
Level three is GT cars, right?
Right?
That's yeah,
I would assume,
sick.
But it
I think it's
going
to go there.
Level three GT cars
single,
that would be pretty awesome. Boss.
Yeah.
That would be pretty awesome.
Single vehicle and then multi-vehicle. Insurance is included, the whole thing. I put in my numbers on the drive over here. And actually
how are the prices? I mean, they're probably
I have to check. I don't know.
But.
They're going to come on our show. They're going to tell us all about it. The kid
are
who
they?
Invented it and pushed it through.
Porsche Drive subscription. Shoot, monthly subscription service gives you the flexibility to drive one or as many Porsches as you desire. All inclusive, comes with insurance, roadside, and maintenance. Yeah.
And a drop service. I think they're bringing everything in from downtown LA's dealership.
Yeah, yeah.
Your new subscription life.
So you can go out to dinner in Beverly Hills and use the app, and they'll switch cars for you.
That's pretty cool.
They deliver it right to you.
I feel like it was like $2,500 for the top level before.
Let's see.
The last one. Oh, here we go. Single vehicle subscription. So for 1 month, 1,500 miles a month is a lot of miles. That's
down,
pretty
down,
good.
Down, 911
activation
from 2,600.
So activation fee is $595, and then you can get $2,600 a month. But that is included insurance, though.
And
so that's pretty good.
It's what's the comparable
good.
Like rental
lease.
From Beverly
or,
Hills rental, like when you wanted to rent a 911?
Would you
way more, right?
Yeah, what you're basically getting.
911 is like $500 a day.
Yeah,
from
so
Beverly
you're
Hills
getting almost like a lease price without all the bullshit
right.
you're
yeah.
getting in a lease.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no commitment.
It's like short term leasing,
yes.
pretty much.
And that's just the subscription. Then there's rental. So you want to come and just use the car for the weekend.
Yeah. That's actually, it's if considering like how. Many ways you can get fucked by leasing. You know, the number sounds good. Oh, $750 a month, whatever.
Yeah,
that sounds
yeah.
good. But then it's like, no. If you try and get out of this, you're fucked. If you decide you want something different, you're fucked. Blah, 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
The buyout,
you're
fucked.
You're fucked.
At the end,
you're
fucked, right?
Those wheels.
So this is
Look
like, yeah, this is kind of like, all right, it's just as expensive.
The rental prices are not bad.
Oh, wow. $395 a day
really
for
low.
A 911? That's great. That's very good.
Yeah.
Seriously. That's pretty good. With 200 miles a day included. That's
and they
great.
Bring it.
I bet you. And if the mileage is so, you could really take advantage of this. If the extra miles are cheap, and they usually are, you could probably drive twice that many miles for like an extra like $60 or $70. You know
think
what I mean?
Think of all the people we've met in Malibu who use Turo after we were all talking about right. Turo and hitting canyons and the number of times we heard from them. And then the car broke down, right?
Really?
Yeah, I heard that. Really? 50% of the time it was like, yeah, we had it, but the car broke down. Mm-hmm. Here you've got these cars all dialed in.
I mean, Turo is like, it's like Airbnb, right? It's a service. But ultimately, the thing that you interact with,
the car, the house, is
the owner,
right.
and how they take care of their shit, you know?
Right.
And it varies highly.
Yeah.
I've driven a couple of cars off Turo. Some of them were very nice. Some of them were beat.
Do I remember you went the Montreal, right?
I drove the Alpha Montreal, but that was not Turo. That was the Haggerty one, drive share. That one's really nice. And that car later sold on Bring a Trailer for $130,000.
Wow. At the height of the Montreal market. That market never, that's like the height of it. And then
at the height.
And now we're down to 80.
The Montreal market doesn't have a height.
It doesn't have anything. Every time it breaks that triple digits, right? $100,000. And then,
that's hilarious.
Yeah.
I would say back to that Porsche drive thing, if I'm totally honest, the Macan rate was not great at $245 a day. But
not compared to not a
great,
Boxster.
But a Boxster for $265 and a 911 for $395 is good.
But if you go 4 days, plus days, you're down to $345 for the 911.
That's good.
Now, if you're going to get something good like an S, a GTS, or a Touring, if they make those, that could be really fun.
It could be, yeah.
I'm going to do it. I have my Land Rover, my daily. I have to turn it in next week.
Really?
So I'm going to do it for October, November, and December.
I'll try the different cars. And you're going to try swapping around cars?
Yeah, because we're building a Land Rover Defender, and, you know, they're telling me it'll be done in November, but you know what that means.
The new one?
Yeah.
You ordered the new one?
No. Yeah, yeah.
Have you driven it yet?
No. Have you?
No.
I'm afraid because I haven't driven it. I saw it at the LA Auto Show.
I saw a couple of them in Malibu. I'm not super sold yet.
Yeah. This one is something my kids really want.
Yeah.
They're really into it. They're really into the Explorer pack and the roof. We have a canoe we want to drive around with.
That's good enough reason.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and
yeah,
it just seems like,
reason.
Yeah, get a beater and something to have fun with.
Would you
with
do that green color that he just put up?
I think that's pretty good. That's what we built. Pangea Green.
You got the four-door, right? Not
the
two-door.
Yeah, the four-door.
Yeah.
With Explorer pack, the ladder, and the whole deal. And we're going to, you know, take it to Gorman. We're going to have some fun with it.
It seems like... It's probably great, but I'm not sold on it just from seeing it drive up the road yet. I want to get one from Land Rover and have it go.
What about the Bronco?
The Bronco looks
kind of
great.
Exciting.
Yeah.
Looks pretty good. They nailed the design.
Yeah.
Absolutely nailed the design.
Yeah. Have you seen that in person yet?
No, I haven't. I've only seen pictures, but I can tell from pictures that it looks great.
I've been lighting them up, trying to get some access.
I don't think there is one yet.
Johnny Lieberman.
Motor Trend is different. No, Motor Trend is different.
Shit.
Yeah, they're different. They got pull and shit. They got the long lead thing. They got the pull, and they got the budget to they'll fly him to Detroit and shit to drive it. They won't. Yeah.
Will that come in a four-door?
Yes, two-door and four-door.
It looks good,
that two-door is
that's
hot,
great
man.
Looking car.
Yeah.
I think on just visual appeal, I think
they're
Bronco beats
it.
Defender.
Oh, yeah.
It could.
And it beats Wrangler.
Yeah.
That's a fabulous looking vehicle.
Yeah.
Really, really great irrational purchase.
I have complaints about the Wrangler. You know,
I have a lot of complaints about the Wrangler.
It's just I was so disconcerted driving it with how much play is in the steering wheel. Makes me fucking nuts.
What year Wrangler was
new
it?
New one. Like,
oh, wow.
Like 18 or 19, something that for my daughter. And then
here you go, Paul. Here's a four-door. That's pretty good, huh?
I love that color.
You got to get the big engine, though. The little engine's no bueno.
Yeah.
The big engine is the twin-turbo 2.7 V6, which is a nice motor.
When are these being delivered?
I have no idea.
You know that, like,
I might be changing my mind right now.
You know that Hennessy will put a 351 in there, right?
Supercharged V8. Yeah. That would be interesting.
Yeah.
But it's going to have this 10-speed auto. Oh, here we go. June 2021. I say hold on. I say wait, Spike.
And you know,
I said, get your Defender.
I ordered one of these.
You ordered a Bronco also?
Yeah.
Did you? Good for
I can't
you.
Make my mind up.
You'll do a swap.
If you don't want the Bronco,
partners.
Maybe I'll take it. Did you order a spec already, or did you just put your name on a list?
A launch edition.
Oh,
yeah,
really expensive edition. One. Oh.
Yeah.
How do you guys feel about buying cars the first year they come out? Because usually that's like, if you do that, they usually have problems.
Yeah.
This is the problem. You're
doing it anyway. You're doing it doubling down.
My dad has been hosed on it twice. Right. I got the wrong head gasket in my Focus RS.
I had the 2014 GT3 with the expanding
engine.
They
took your engine back.
Yeah. Oh, I took they took the whole car back.
Oh yeah.
I just said fuck it, just take it back.
Oh, they took the whole car?
Yeah, that was the option. You could have a new engine, or you could give it back.
The whole car.
See you later. Thank you.
I read that replacing all of those engines wiped out the profit of the entire GT3 program up till that point.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely.
They had to replace so many engines.
Oh, well.
Yeah, it sucks. And then there was the touring, and the profit came back.
Yes. Yeah. And the R.
Boy, did they milk us.
The R.
Yeah.
Did you guys happen to see that picture that I reposted from somebody's feed? With the GT3 with the giant wing on
the
it.
The swan neck
wing. Is it on your Instagram?
Yeah. Go to my Instagram and tell me, Matt, what you think we're looking at here.
A GT3 with a giant wing, like extra wing?
Yeah. Extra, and it's got, then the way it's set up, they call it a swan neck.
Right at the top, right above the, right to the right of the Aston.
Oh, this weird, that thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Take a look at this.
Oh. Oh, is this this is the 992 GT3?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This is the new GT3.
What are we looking at here?
So if
you play the first one, there's video. You can see.
I hope that's the RS and not the regular GT3 because that's excessive. So the newest thing, the thing is with the GT with a big wing.
Okay, but wait, look.
Right.
Look at those front intakes. Look at the size
of
that thing.
That's something special. That's not a GT3. That's something extra.
Exactly. What do you think it is?
That's a GT2 RS or something.
That's what I think.
I think that's a GT2 RS.
But they get more downforce, better aerodynamics.
So the idea with that wing is that race cars did this first, and then Koenigsegg's been doing it. Mm-hmm. The underside of the wing actually does more work than the top of the wing does. And so by having the stanchions attached to the top and smoothing out the underside of the wing, you get more function than having the stanchions mount under the wing with a clean top. Mm-hmm. That's the theory. I'm sure it's actually fact, not theory.
Do we think vehicles with that giant biplane wing are going to be rolling out of the Porsche factory?
I hope, because at this point,
it's massive. That is massive.
We have to go there. We have to go to 59 Cadillac wings. We have to go so far past the mark.
Uh-huh. Just to keep people interested?
Yes.
It's almost Senna-like, the supports for it. That shot you just had up there.
You know, that's interesting. They might be, you know, they did the 935, right? What if there's a 934 or something that they're going to do, you know, that's really like a streetcar version of... I mean, that's fucking crazy.
I saw Pappas' 935. Wow.
That looks crazy. Is it the Bear Carbon one? Is that his?
Yeah. Sick. Holy shit.
I talked to Jeff Zwart, who was running one of those up Pikes Peak, who said it was as easy to drive as a GT3 streetcar.
Yep.
Absolutely just easy as pie.
Dude, I was confused because I went and filmed Pikes Peak and we filmed Jeff's car, and all the cars I was filming were race cars. And then I opened the door to Jeff's car and I'm like, where am I? And it's like, oh, because it's just like the same dash, same shifter. I mean, it's got like the wood shifter, but it just looks like 992. Mm-hmm. It's very strange.
Yeah.
It was very funny when I drove CJ Wilson's Cayman GT4 streetcar and Cayman GT4 Club Sport on the same day because he ordered his streetcar special with AC and radio delete, but his race car had both because they just pulled cars off the line to build the race cars. So it had like dual zone climate control and a radio in it. It was hilarious.
Bizarre.
Yeah, really strange. And it was nice though. It was hot at Willow Springs. I was happy to have it. Didn't really affect performance. But that's got to be something. That's got to be a GT2 RS. It's a crazy wing.
Do you like that, Zuckerman?
No, that's ugly as hell.
Look at the little corner really lights ugly. There off the bumper.
I don't like it. It's distinctly ugly. There's a whole bunch of shit on the back of that car that I don't like.
I agree with you, though, Matt. I think that's a GT2 RS.
I think it's a GT2 RS, but I also think it has a bunch of extra body shit on it to disguise it. I don't think the shape of the body is accurate.
Right.
But I think if they're using a wing design like that, it's very bold, but it's only for the top model.
Now, there were
model.
Some who thought that little ducktail that said it was a GT3 Touring, that this giant wing was a big distraction. But why would they
do
that?
That's hilarious.
Oh, false flag.
That was false flag QAnon.
Yes.
It would be really if Porsche had a sense of humor, that would be a funny Porsche. The funny Porsche joke.
But the GT2 RS has that little ducktail. That's why everybody takes it off. They take the big wing off, and that little wing is left, right? Yeah, yeah, so that's already part of it.
I think that's GT2 RS.
Yeah.
Or possibly, well, it's got the center exhaust. It might be GT3 RS.
Could be.
Has center exhaust.
Yeah.
That could be GT3 RS. I don't know. If they leave that crazy wing design just for the top one, I'd be okay with it. But I hope that doesn't become the standard because it ruins your ability to have breakfast on the wing.
Oh yeah, but check it out.
What it's really about.
Yeah. If you took a look at the 997 wings, and if you were 997 era and they told you, and he showed you 991 wings, what was coming in the future, you would think it was that insane as well.
Totally.
Maybe.
Yeah.
That the over-the-top thing, though, I mean, I've only really seen that on, like...
Well, Lambo has it.
And the crazy Lambos.
And the Koenigsegg, of course.
And the Koenigsegg is, I was going to say, the only place
but
I've seen it.
But more and more and more race cars also run it. So I think it's just, if you want to shave those lap times so that you can sell the next car, you got to do what's the best thing to do.
Yeah, that's true. I guess the 997 RS wing was pretty wild.
The RS 4.0 wing was out there.
Yeah.
God, that was nice looking.
I like that you had to make the Porsche wings taller in the aftermarket, not for more downforce, just so you can see out the fucking window, because they block the window right from the factory every single time.
Who was telling us about the cops were after him? Oh, I was having lunch with a friend of mine. And he was getting chased by a cop in his GT3. And he had no idea that the motorcycle guy was behind him because the wing was blocking. And so the guy was so outraged, gave him a ticket for evasion.
That's hilarious.
Well. Yes.
I bet you could beat that in court.
He did beat it.
Did he?
He did, but for other reasons.
What were the other reasons? How do you beat that?
It was a very technical reason because he was outside of his jurisdiction. And as a cop outside of his jurisdiction, he should have filed his ticket in the county seat and not in the local courthouse. He did the procedure wrong.
I love technicalities.
Yes. And that resulted in the ticket getting thrown out. And my friend was saying the cop was there. He was ready to go for the hearing. And he was bragging about how he had never lost a case. And he was looking forward to getting this guy who he'd had his eye out for.
Yeah.
And he didn't even get to go in and testify. They walked out. It was dismissed.
Shout out to our sponsor, Off the Record, by the way. Helps you find a qualified attorney to fight your ticket in any state in the U.S. So you get a ticket out of state, you don't know who you're going to call, right? You don't know the lay of the land. Off the Record's got you covered.
Relieves them.
That's like very satisfying to beat a cop on a technicality when you show that level of confidence. Like I'm gonna beat the fuck out of that ticket I got for allegedly doing 110 in the Turbo S. That cop's got nothing.
I wish you could beat it with like logic or the argument though, and just say I couldn't see you because of this. I wish you could just.
I'd love to
do that instead of going.
That doesn't work.
I know it doesn't work. No, I know it doesn't work. I tried.
Yeah,
I absolutely tried once.
A clever lawyer. In this case, it was my partner Keith Bruno who made all of those arguments. He killed it.
I like it.
Yeah. Ignorance is no excuse for the law, son.
Yeah, I don't want to hear your story.
You can't see it. Get glasses.
I had to run. Somebody's cat got torn off the girl's face.
Throw a cat in the car. Rip his face off. Oh. Fuck you.
I did have a case once where animal control was racing to the scene of a feral cat. and ran this poor fucker over and killed him.
Whoa. Yeah, oh ran God. Her over. Yeah, yeah poor
killed
fucker.
Him. Killed,
killed
him.
Him.
Wow.
Him.
Oh, yep. My God.
Wow.
A feral cat?
Yeah.
Do they have lights on that vehicle or is it just jamming?
He was exactly what you thought, what you would think of that guy.
Wow.
Yeah. Going to save a woman at night who said she could not get out her front door because there was a feral cat there.
And he murdered somebody.
And he killed somebody. And it's like, lady, why don't you just go out the garage? Why are you going? Right. Go out another fucking door. Sure, you don't have one door in your house. Go out a different door.
It's like a horror movie. The cat's at every door.
The feral cat's
at her door. So she calls up to animal control, freaking out. I can't go out my front door. There's a feral cat there. And some goober in like green shorts and a green shirt gets in the animal control truck and is going down Street of the Valley as fast as he can.
It's his moment. That's
his moment.
Moment
to shine. It's his moment to shine.
What song from what movie do you think he's humming in his head?
I am the tiger.
Of course. I was going to go with Danger Zone.
Either will work. And my poor guy
and
had a couple of six packs. Crossing the street where he shouldn't be, maybe a little tipsy. And it was and meeting in the night.
Oh, Jesus.
Beers everywhere. Beers and blood.
Oh, my
terrible
God.
Terrible story.
Yeah. Cans rolling down the street.
I mean, the cat, any feral cat I've seen, you look at them and they run away, right? You can't even come near them.
That's what I'm talking about. I said to the guy.
Did this lady feel any responsibility?
I didn't talk
for
to her. She didn't have the problem. I was talking to the,
she has
I
a
was
problem.
Talking to the driver.
Right.
And I said, really, you got a call. Tell me what you did. You were going. He wanted to say he was going code 3. And I said, sir, there's no code 3 for animal control and a feral
well,
cat.
Well, a tiger. Right? Like, I mean, if there was a lion or a gorilla loose, there might be a code
maybe,
3.
But in this case, right? In this case.
Yeah, they have to go the speed limit. They're not allowed to skirt traffic laws.
To go 80 miles an hour to get there in time before the cat's gone.
Do they have lights and sirens on animal control? Do you think he put one?
Yeah. He goes up like Starsky and
Hutch. We're going in. We're going in.
Did he? Wasn't
warp speed.
He prepped by the city to not say those things?
Okay, do you really think that the guy that would do this would stick to the script, Feresten? That's my skill. They're given a script, and then I just poke a little bit, and it all unravels, and the mouth starts running, and then they tell the whole story. I had to get there. There was a lady calling.
So you put them on the defensive, and they get mad.
And they buckle.
Yeah, it depends on the person, but generally maybe it's the cock of the eye, or you just the way you look at somebody. It's my.
And didn't opposing counsel go, okay, that's enough. Let's just stop for a second. Hold on.
I'm a bully with that person.
You are?
Of course.
What do you do when I say that?
Don't interrupt me. You'll get your turn. Don't coach the witness.
You just bully them into being quiet, and then you're allowed to continue.
Feresten, if you were an attorney, you would know a truth that most defense attorneys, they gas out after 5 minutes of fight. And it could be 5 minutes about anything. It could be five minutes over the guy's address. They got 5 minutes of fight in them. And if you get them to gas out on something unimportant early, they're kind of like slumped out for the rest of the depot when you're going after.
Is that, really, is that like a human thing where people don't like to defend as much as they like to attack?
Most people just don't have it. They're lazy. They're unmotivated. I'm going for the money. And they are just going for a paycheck. Mm. And so whatever the deal is they gas
this is
out.
Great.
They gas out quick so I can get them to argue about something irrelevant early. And then they're just done. They're slumped over. They don't have it anymore. Wow. I'm getting everything.
How interesting.
Wow. Yeah, most people just, they don't have it.
They just don't have the endurance for it.
And that's why I always say, like, you and Lieberman, I see you guys have worthy opponents to fight. Both kind of psycho.
Well, to build this place, you got to keep fighting.
Called endurance. See, execution is 95% of the battle. 5% is the idea.
Yeah.
Everybody's got this idea. I'm going to build a car source. Most people don't have the resources you have.
Yeah.
But putting those that
no,
aside.
You still have to show up every day for a very long time.
It's fucking brutal, right?
Yeah.
It's brutal. And
not even that. Even without resources, a lot of people email me and they go, dude, I really want to do what you do. I want to write about cars. I go, okay.
Do
write me like five things.
You never hear from again.
And either I never hear from them again, or I go, and I go, okay, now write five more. And that's the end.
They'll
and it's just
never
tapped the fuck out. And I go, it's like, dude, you got to come up with a new thing to do with yourself every day for a decade. Like, you got that? Yeah.
Right.
You know, sorry.
That's what
I
always say, execution.
Yeah.
It's all in the execution.
Yeah. You actually have to show up every single fucking day.
And I think it's interesting.
How many shows do you have to pitch to get one?
Oh, just jokes.
Or jokes.
We used to say about writing for Letterman that we were mining 1 square inch of a football field straight down to China. That's what like that 1 square inch is what Dave will put on the air, and we're just going to jam down that hole that long.
You see someone looking up.
Yeah,
from China.
Buttafuoco, just whatever he was on. Madonna, Buttafuoco jokes. You know, Bill Clinton, the dress, and you just eight times a day, generating. Eight pages of jokes with the same kind of touch point. It was wild.
Wow.
But you get in a flow state with it. It's good.
God, writing like 10, just being like, okay, give me 10 jokes about Joey Buttafuoco. Like, that's got to be fucking,
it would never come across that way. No, you would do, you would do opening remarks before coffee. Like, you'd come in and just write 10 quick jokes based on headlines. That was just the start of your day, a warm-up thing. Mm-hmm. And then stuff would start to come under your door. Hey, we're doing, we've got some footage at the boat show. So here's some clips of the boat show, write jokes for that. You just see a weird guy walking around. You go, is this guy A, potential customer, B, a boat salesman, C, one of the boat show's many specialized hookers, right? The guy with the captain's hats, right? So you do that for a little while. And then it would be top 10 topics. Give us six top 10 topics based on the 30 minutes later. Here's the one we picked. Give us 25 jokes for that. And so you just start, you learn to jam, but it was really, you know, grad school for comedy writing.
Yeah.
You just learn to work fast and not think too much. And
you ever see the South Park, was it 6 days to air, seven days to air? Is it called 7 days to air or 6 days? 6 days to air. They literally have nothing for an episode 6 days before it airs every fucking week.
That's great.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Build it from scratch.
So crazy.
And you see in the back of the New Yorker magazine, they've always got the blank cartoons. And they're soliciting what the captions are.
Oh, so
there's a blank. Then the next week they've got the three top ones, and the following week they'll show who the winner is. So it cycles through three weeks.
Good.
Have you ever tried?
No, I have no interest in that.
Be my hero.
I'm not a fan of their I always look at them, and it's like some weird guy with spectacles, and he's holding a red ball, and it goes, however what? And I'm like, what the fuck are they talking about? Like, the jokes are so goddamn,
I think you understand
weird.
It better than you think you do.
It's snobby, snooty, inside baseball.
Yeah, I don't like it.
I like my
jokes to make sense in some way. They
the Playboy
can be strange,
ones were always great.
Yes.
The Playboy like cartoons were always super
good. Yeah, those are all right.
Yeah, I like those.
Yeah. I like Archie, too. I like Richie Rich.
The endurance is, I think, what gets rid of you. You always see guys who'll restore a car. They're 4 years in, and they get it, and they sell it right away.
Yeah, yeah.
The trauma of the restoration, they never want to drive the end product.
Yeah.
Happens a lot.
Yeah.
Because the pain, you start driving your pain.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you worry about every little thing, and it's just...
Yeah.
That's why it's nice to give the car to somebody and hand them a check, and then that comes back, and it's nice, then you drive it.
Right.
But I've been thinking about what you guys were saying the other day when I was on your show about the real difference between a true low-mile car and, like, a nicely restored car.
You mean completely different?
They're really not the same thing at all. That's interesting. It's just like it makes...
Mm-hmm. Factory is always factory.
It's crazy. I
mean, even with a
genius
like Will
Hoyt,
it's a little different.
Even with the best, it cannot be exactly replicated. It's kind of sad.
A little bit. They're only original once, a very old line.
But you're deciding what you like to drive. Like, I have found when I have a car that I've worked on too much or restored... On any given day where I really hate myself, it bleeds into those decisions I did on the restoration.
Right.
As opposed to, I'm having a shitty day and I get into something Porsche made and it's all original, and then you're transported, right?
Hmm.
My personality is not allowed to contaminate it because I didn't make the decisions other than to
purchase
it.
You're just transported
to
66 or whatever year it was made.
Right, right.
That's interesting.
Yeah. But it can happen with these things that you restore. You start to...
It's funny.
What
if you were to buy something that was like a full, closest factory can be restoration? Same thing or not?
It depends if somebody else did it. I would prefer and this is I don't know that this is a weird thing just with me, but even when I was on the East Coast fishing, I preferred to eat somebody else's fish that they caught, not mine. I might get a boatload of bluefish and strike bass. What?
The fish is always stinky.
That's horrible.
Is there a metaphor?
I prefer
somewhere?
Yes.
But there was something about the idea of catching this fish and taking it apart and the guts and everything. I just never wanted to eat the one I did it to because I knew too much about what had happened from the water to my plate.
You poor person.
No, I like steak.
I'm just being
honest. Steak, but I don't want to go kill the cow.
Right, and I feel
I don't even really want to visit where they're doing that.
Sometimes I feel that way about these restored cars.
Yeah.
You know what?
I'll buy your restored car because I can trust you or Zuckerman's, but I don't want to do it myself.
The San Beige 67 I have, which I bought, and it's it's very, very, very original. But it was sitting a little too high. And Will, I sent it to Will Hoyt to work on the suspension, and he lowered it to Will Hoyt low. And I'm kind of regretting the decision.
Is that like a few millimeters below stock?
Yes.
Yeah, I saw it.
And it's
they always go, this is the way they should have done it from the factory.
And I'm like looking at it now, and now I'm feeling like I shouldn't have done it. I went too far. I went.
Can you tell
bit.
The difference in the ride?
Yes, it's much better. Oh, it's much better now, but I might have to raise it up in the back just a little bit.
Because of it looks or because of how it feels to drive?
Both. Both.
Yeah.
More looks, though. More looks for me, because the car, for whatever reason, was really high up in the back. And over the course of 6 years, I got used to it sitting up that high. And there was something about the floaty nature of that car that was kind of charming.
Right.
Yeah.
But it is an S, right?
Yeah. So it
shouldn't be floaty.
No, it shouldn't. It shouldn't. But I was used to it that way.
I understand.
And that's the way I got it.
I do think it looks great now.
You do?
I think that was the right move. It's an S, because it's an S. I always thought it never quite felt like an S.
Did he have to change any parts to adjust the height?
Not very much. Not very much. I haven't put a picture on my Instagram of the new low height, but if you go down a little...
I saw it the other day at your shop. It's quite nice.
It's quite nice.
It's a good little car.
It's a great little car.
The
look at this! Some of my mistakes and some of my wins. So this is like the scorecard of my life up here.
What are the mistakes?
I don't want to say, but go down and I'll see really if I catch funny. One. There's a few, but I don't see where it.
Remember that silver R129 SL I had.
Yes, I did love that car.
It's a really nice car, but I put the Euro spec lowering springs in it, and I loved how it looked afterwards, but I could tell that was not how Mercedes designed the front end to drive. It was just different.
That looks pretty good, too.
So this is the current height or the old height?
No, that was the old height.
Oh, I kind of like this canted forward hot rod look.
Yes. And now it's pinched down much lower
in the
back.
It's got like half a degree forward of forward rake, and I
and
really
Will
like
Hoyt said,
it.
And said it was really, it was not right at all, but I kind of dug the look of it.
Yeah, that looks good. Yeah. So the back end was a little floaty, though?
A little, yeah.
So did he lower the front, too, or just the back?
I think the front was just a little bit, and the back was a lot of it, like a full inch. So it might have to come up a quarter inch.
It's a cool car, though.
Yeah, like, it's fantastic.
That's a good one.
What is Lemur Inc. saying to you right there?
Are the birds still talking to you?
Lemur Inc.
Oh. I don't, I think he's on a little bit too much Yale. I think he's
had a long night
Yale.
In Beverly Hills and doesn't know what's going on.
He heard the
on.
Birds come up in the morning.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
People are weird right now.
Spike, what's your press car flow been like?
Pretty like you. Lots of stuff coming. I'm in the new Aston Martin Vantage Roadster today. There it is.
I can't talk about it, right?
It's embargoed. I think you're getting that.
I get it next week.
Really beautiful, I'll say that.
We can say that it looks good. The color combo is pretty cool. Yes. This blue, very
ceramic
bright blue.
It's very much like a Mexico blue.
Yeah.
It's a little darker right there.
That's a very Jerry color.
And I've been driving a lot of Ducatis, as you know. I'm just in love with Ducati. And I'm in love with Bentley right now. Those are the two brands that have really stood out to me.
You
got to
hook me up with the Bentley people. I need to drive the new GT.
I will pay it forward because Johnny Lieberman hooked me up, and I'll get you hooked up.
Yeah.
These cars are amazing now because Porsche's involved.
Because the Bentley Flying Spur is a Panamera platform.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, the Continental GT is a shortened Panamera platform, right?
That's the new quote, that's like what a 928 would be in theory, kind of.
I like the Continental GT. It just suits me more. They're both fantastic cars, but that Continental GT I had, that's the Flying Spur.
Oh, and he drove
one right there, the black one. This guy?
Yeah, look at that.
Oh, the black CGT is hot.
Did that feel... When you sit down, it feels you're just in love.
They really killed the look on that.
I haven't driven it, but I sat, and I think it was that very press car when somebody had
look
it.
Look how
it,
lovely that
it
is.
It really feels like money.
Yes.
It feels like
but
a
you know how
money.
A car doesn't confuse you the first time you sit down? That's one of the things I look for. When I first sit down, I look around. Everything is there. It ergonomically, it makes sense. I reach and the thing I want just happens to be there.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what happened here.
That's good.
That somehow Porsche or Volkswagen, they got into to Bentley and said, you're at about 96%. Let us get you to 100.
Yeah.
The steering wheel feels perfect.
Wow, the wood on that photo is amazing.
And then with the infotainment system, Feresten did something that he was excited, like you're a teenager in high school. Hey, look at this. And he made it turn around. Oh, yeah.
The flipping screens.
Yeah, it's got a triangular screen. Yeah, so it turns one way, a second way, then a third way with dials.
You had very teenage excitement when you were showing.
That's some James Bond shit,
yeah.
right?
It was just fun. And I found the Continental GT to be a very usable daily car. It was just silent inside.
Yeah, it's supposed to be.
The Flying Spur, we went out to dinner. We went out for hamburgers in it, and it was super fun with the family, but it is a lot to drive by yourself.
A big car.
A very big car. Yeah. You want to be driven in it.
Yeah. It's kind of limo. It's very limo-y.
Yeah, smaller, but it feels very heavy. And
did you ever drive a Mulsanne?
No.
Mulsannes were like driving a freight train. They were incredible. It was like you'd hit the gas, and it was like it did that, you know, where the front end, the nose really rises up as you're going, and it's like red line at 5,400 RPM.
We could get one for $19,000 too right now. Let's share one.
Plan Z.
I'll plan Z
a Mulsanne. That'd be amazing. Yeah, those spurs are good. I like that. I want to try the GT though.
How'd you like
Boxer Spider? I had that one a couple months before you.
Okay, that was another fantastic car. That took a few days for me to get used to. I kept thinking I was about to get into a Boxster, and the first day I'm like, this isn't really a Boxster. And the second day, this isn't the Boxster I remember. Then I realized this isn't a Boxster.
It's a baby speed.
This is a baby GT3, you know, cab of some kind.
And that's what it looked like when I was watching you drive. That I was really impressed with the looks.
And you're shifting gears in it, and it's light, and it's nice up in the canyons. And I really fell in love with that car too. It's unique in that Porsche lineup.
I asked Frank Weissman at Porsche for special permission to put 1,500 miles in a week on that car. And he said it was cool, and I did. I drove it, and I literally drove it to Santa Rosa, California, to Guy Fieri's house for Carl's memorial. Like, it was actually almost exactly a year ago. It was like 2 weeks shy of a year ago.
And what did you think?
It was amazing. It was an amazing car. It's the second best engine in the world, except for the GT3's 4-liter.
Right.
And I haven't heard one with an aftermarket exhaust yet. That could really help a lot.
It's definitely quieter.
Yeah. Well, the one I drove was the Euro one that had the Euro filter thing.
That's the one Jerry and I were in last year.
Right. The same blue one, yeah.
And, you know, you probably know more than me about it, but the sound, it seems like sound, like that new Ferrari. Things are getting lower decibel levels, right?
They need to.
Is that DOT? Yeah.
I think it's European standards. It's not American standards.
I don't mind it necessarily. And
they still sell Jaguar F-Type V8s here. I don't think our standards have changed.
No, but it was something Andy Pruniger said to us. You know, I don't even know if he admitted saying it, but he
said sound was a problem.
He said, keep that GT2 RS. We're never going to be able to make a sound like that again.
Really?
And I thought what he was talking about was decibel level.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sound pollution, noise pollution.
Yeah. Huh. That things were coming down. And then this Ferrari came in, the F8 Spider. And that was quieter, and I didn't mind it. And, you know,
I was not pleased with it.
You didn't like it?
Sound wise or everything wise?
No, the F8. The F8 is a lovely car, but in my opinion, it is the one I drove was very expensive. It was almost $400,000. Mm-hmm. So it was a Spider. The coupes clearly are like $40,000 cheaper, but it was not meaningfully different from like a 458. And it didn't sound as good. And like, yeah, it has more power and all that. But like, it wasn't more usable. Like, the extra power wasn't that usable. You know what I mean? And so for the price difference from a low mile 2012 458 or something to this, you're talking about like $250,000 extra dollars.
But wouldn't you compare it to the 488?
It was almost exactly the same as the 488, except it was more expensive and even quieter.
Yeah.
Dynamically, I could not tell the difference.
So you're saying that of the three,
saying there's so much value in a $160,000 458 right now. So much value. And there's less value in the newer cars. But, like, it's still lovely. Like, it's a great car.
Beautiful.
But, like, and it was beautiful and very, very fast and sounds nice and it's comfortable and all those things that these Ferrari mid-engine cars are. It's just like it's new Ferrari price, and underneath that, it's kind of an old car. Like, it's a 458 under there. It's the same. It's the same. You know what I mean? So, and you know, they're sorry if they don't like to hear that.
Do you think that's also true with Lamborghini? Like, because the Huracan's gotten so good and so fast compared to, you know, Gallardo. Like,
well,
like I'm saying,
I think the Huracan's a different. It's a new platform.
To go back to what you said, like the newer cars don't have the same magic as the older cars. Are there any new cars?
You got to go even older that have the magic. Those GT3s with a stick, they got it.
Touring, speedster, spider.
It's not about how fast you can go anymore, because everyone can go that fast. It's about how it makes you feel. Like that Mercedes I've got outside or downstairs or wherever the hell it is, I've got this GT53 thing, which has a fucking awesome interior, Zuckerman. If you haven't seen it yet, why isn't there a picture on my Instagram? Refresh that, Zach.
Yeah.
Because I definitely put a picture on my Instagram, like, today. There it is. Go over the interior. It's a couple, slide over to the right. Because this interior is bananas. It is so red. It is the most red that you could make leather. It's wild.
It looks like neoprene. Red neoprene.
But it's leather. Scroll one more, because the dash is quite beautiful, actually. I think they did really. Those turbine vents are fabulous. Air vents are really, really nice. They did a great job. Mm-hmm. But it's the 53, right? So it's this 48-volt mild hybrid turbo 6. It makes a bunch of power, but it's not that grumbly, nasty, snarly AMG, right? So, like, if AMG sold me the 53 that was the V8 without the turbos and it sounded gnarly, you know, it made me feel like, arr! This is kind of like, it visually looks like the AMG, but the feel, the sensory thing, it's just not there, which is unfortunate. Because it's a very cool engine, and it's a very pretty car. It's expensive, though. For it's $125,000. And for that, you don't get the crazy motor. You got to go 150 to get the crazy motor. But I haven't gone to the canyons with it. I've only driven it around, but like, that's it. That's the same thing. Like, it doesn't have the
that when I, you get a 6.3, I will give you my 69 6.3 for you to do the comparison.
How is that thing?
You'll love it. You will love that giant V8 engine with all that torque, all that power. You'll love the seating position. You'll love the air suspension, the long back seat. Everything about it screams, you know, it screams
it's
the kind
very
of,
me.
And also a little bit of the ad hoc nature of the way things were done back then.
I mean, 69 Mercedes 300 SEL, 6.3. How many different engines came with this thing? There was a 6 and 2.8s?
You could get, well, there was a 280 SEL.
Oh,
So there was a 280 SEL with a 2.8. Then there was the 300 SEL with, you could get a 3.5. You could get a 4.5 in a 300 SEL.
I drove a 4.5 car, and I remember it being fucking awesome.
Yes.
Like, amazingly, shockingly great.
And this takes it to the next level, and you would be surprised. I always thought they underrated the car horsepower-wise, because they said 250 horsepower with 397 foot-pounds of torque. That seemed a little out of balance.
That math is off.
It's off. Yeah. It was probably a little over 300.
Yeah.
And now, the prior owner put some AMG pistons in there or did some work, early AMG
Zuckerman
work.
Zuckerman popped the hood at Bell's. It's something else under there. It's fucking cool.
And you would like the amount of motivation the car has.
Motivation is a great word. Top comment on this post from Chris Harris. I will have one of these at some point.
Spectacular.
That's a very Chris Harris car, too.
Yes.
Chris Harris would buy a car like that.
Yes.
Yeah. I the one I drove, I was so, like, you think of them as being solid, but it's so much more solid than it even looks.
Vault-like,
even compared to it's more solid than, like, a 2020 car.
You know, because they were making a point. This is post-World War II. They're making a point. Okay, we're back. We have enough steel. We have the engineering, the technology. We're going to show the world what we're going to make.
It's awesome.
Not the shisa that the Americans were putting out.
Yeah. And I drove.
That's gorgeous. I really just want to drive.
I drove a short distance today in a car that is so big that it uses its length in inches as a in the name of the car as a bragging point.
What is that?
It was a Buick Electra 225.
I saw that downstairs in the basement.
25 inches long.
That's weird.
Yeah, and it's a customer. It's actually, not only is it a customer, it's a customer car, but I could talk about it because it's my podcast ad sales agent's car. And hilarious. He's a dude who's like about my age, about my build and style, and he just loves enormous cars. Jeez. And he's got this giant, it's a two-door.
It's an earlier version of that,
it's
right?
A 64.
Earlier.
64 Buick Electra 225. And it is absolutely enormous.
In a seafoam color, right?
It's like that blue. It's like that really nice GM. That one's got a Landau roof. This one does not have the Landau, but that's
where you think Landau came from.
Yeah, Martin Landau roof.
Like his eyebrows.
Landau Calrissian roof.
Yes. And this has got, 445, 425 horsepower.
A wildcat engine, they call it.
This thing has like the most torque, like from 800 RPM, it makes like...
To 3,000.
To put this thing, like, to drive it over the tiny little hump, you just have to give it the centimeter, and it's like, it wants to, like, jump out of its own tire.
You get all that torque, you can hear the belts straining.
Oh, my God.
Built to crash into telephone poles.
Yeah. Just. Yes.
And this one we've
don't
got
try to turn
mint.
It.
That one, the one we have here, it's got 20,000 miles on it. It's mint. That's like the factory new. I was like, this is what this was like in a showroom. But my guys are like, my guys who work here, they're pretty young. They're like in their 20s. And so they can't fathom this car. They do not
understand.
One of my guys literally does the cross before he parks the thing.
Really?
Yeah.
It's
so big.
The whole world was like that.
Well, that's what I tell you.
Dinosaurs roam on the highways.
I can't believe this car is so big. And I go, imagine a world where this is every car.
Yeah.
With bad brakes and lots of power.
You're running over kids. Yeah. You're backing over them in driveways. Oh, yeah, it was nuts.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing anyone got out alive. You guys want to plug anything before we wrap this shindig? Spike Star Radio?
You know, I forgot to mention, I'm going to be giving away a couple of rental weekends in that Porsche program.
Oh, you are?
For listeners in October and in November.
What do people have to do?
All they have to do is follow me on Instagram, and I am going to put the post up in a couple weeks, and then just comment. And they will be automatically entered into a free, I believe it's a 9/11, free weekend with a 9/11 anywhere in the United States.
Really?
Yeah.
Whatever this scam is you've got going, I want in on it.
It's not a scam.
I need a lease for a quarter as well.
It's no secret that we like Porsches.
I think
Porsche finally noticed.
I think West Side Collector Car Storage should be the West LA hub.
Yes.
They should rent a quad stack, man. Get over here. Guys, Porsche... Come rent a quad stack.
And we'll be out there doing that show on the 20th.
Was that the 20th? Sunday the 20th?
That's Sunday the 20th.
Sunday.
Are you going this Sunday?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm definitely going. Okay. What kind of scissors are you going to bring?
I'm
going
to bring my garden shears. Yeah.
Should we like out cutting utensils? Like I'll bring like a chainsaw.
Here's the most important one to get down is the one right on PCH at the Shell station. Like that's unattended. You just cut it and that's where
noticed. In front of the Shell station they put one?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
But what if all I you bring, have to do is go...
What if I drive the Safari just right through it?
Over, yes.
Just right over it.
Do it.
No, it's you might hurt your car. You might scratch your car.
Not that car.
It's too high.
Oh,
it's
really?
Like windshield level high.
Oh, it's like hitting a moose, huh?
Yeah, what you would do is just pull up and just clip, and it's going to fall.
Weed whacker, right out the weed whacker right with the saw attachment.
We have a right to buy coffee at this place. Stop.
That's hilarious.
Stop.
All of this is fabulous.
Excellent. Yeah, this is fun.
Yeah, okay. Come out. Bring your scissors, folks. Biggest scissors wins.
Yes. Yes. Now we're doing something.
Thank you guys for coming down, man.
You're welcome.
I appreciate
congrats.
I appreciate you lending me cars for my open house. They look great in my photos. Pull up the website, Zach, WCCS.com, because we finally... It was a milestone today because I replaced all of the computer generated renderings on my website with actual photographs that indicate that we are actually open for business.
So people have to come in. They have to be on the ground floor and look up the scale, the height.
Yeah.
It's really
cool.
It's beyond cool, man.
And
it's
the cigar lounge, which we're about to
hit. Are we
going to
have a cigar?
We are.
Nice.
Because I have to tell you that this was just a dirt lot.
Yeah.
That you went down and then up as high. Impressive.
Thanks, man.
I am impressed.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah. You get the friend rate anytime when you overflow your buildings.
Yeah.
You can the lighting in our underground level is amazing. It makes any car look so
really
boss.
Sick. Yeah, it's sick.
Yeah, it's
Wesley
really
Snipes sick. Should be walking away from that right now.
Yeah, that caddy's about to explode. Yeah. A man is going to walk away from it very slowly.
Did you see our video that we made for you? Did that ever make it
yes.
to you?
Yes. No, no, I did. Yes. Hannah.
Did you laugh?
Yes.
I thought that was a pretty good joke. Hannah, about Rome.
Hannah told me on the day that we opened, she goes, I need you for 20 minutes. And I go, 20? I go, I don't have 20 minutes. I go, you can have 20 minutes later. I didn't say this to my wife, but I was like running around. So later, before bed, she was like, can I have your 20 minutes? And I was like, yes. Yeah. So she sat me down and started playing this video. And it was a series of clips from very close friends, many of whom couldn't be here for the opening, but some who did come, of people just, you know, well-wishing and making funny jokes and making fun of me. And Spike said, you know, Matt, Rome wasn't built in a day, but it certainly took less time than this building.
And then I said, Zuckerman, what do you have to say?
I think I held my head and said, I don't got time for this.
Zuckerman's like, I don't have time for this bullshit. It was really funny. No, it's so many people made really, really nice ones. But like, you know, it was 20 seconds at a time, and it was legitimately 20
touching
minutes
wow.
long.
You are wow. like
there
Farrah.
Were so many people that made videos.
I know you
really,
I know
really
you
nice.
Doubt that you're lovable, but we do love you.
Thank you.
Yes.
You guys want to go have a cigar on the cigar deck?
Yeah.
All right. That's our show.
I've had enough.
WCCS.com if you want to keep your car where the cool kids keep their cars. And that's it. The Smoking Tire Podcast is powered by Shout Engine. Get your own damn podcast at shoutengine.com. It's easy. All you need is a microphone, a connection to the internet, and ideally something to say. Our next episode, actually, is going to be the return of Chris Hayes from Shout Engine. Chris Hayes is going to come in and do a show with us. And then next, we actually have three shows next week.
Mm-hmm.
Who's coming in after Chris Hayes? Who do we have? Oh, Glucker, right? I believe, no, maybe Glucker. And then my wife's boss, who is, I believe, the number two or three person at Twitter, which is going to be very, very cool. I'm excited for that. Dantley Davis is going to be coming in next week. Thanks, guys. That's our show. Bye. Spike's Car Radio. Listen.